1, 2, 1, 2, 3. I was headed out your door, determined that I would go, when a tornado warning came on a music show. I was scared of the howling wind blowing around the town, so I quickly changed my plans and I settled down. Yeah, but it was no tornado. Saved by the warmest part of your soul. I looked to the east, birds were flying by. I looked to the west, I saw a darkened sky. All of the world was turning, all in that dreadful storm.
Okay, we're back. Kevin Hypes, Planet Hypes. Please subscribe. Just do everything you're supposed to do to build my subscription here. But the purpose for this is I'm telling stories. I'm going to write a book, and I'm going to be telling stories. I think I say that every episode. I probably don't have to. But anyway, I'm kind of at a kid in Levittown, a bit of a teenager right now. And there's so many great memories and stories about this time of my life. Some of them I'm not really proud of. I did some things that I probably shouldn't have done when I was a kid, so I don't want any of you kids out there copying me. But these are things I did, and I'm going to document them. In any case, I'm talking about some of the rock and roll things because now I'm like 15-ish and I'm growing my hair. I'm starting to play guitar and I'm wanting to do rock and roll things. So this story is about me and a buddy of mine named Mike Rudnick. And he won't mind me using his name. He's a very good friend of mine. Well, we used to sleep out a lot. And what we would do is, you know, back then you didn't have tents. Back then you took a blanket and you threw it over your mother's clothesline and you just stuck sticks in the ground to make it a tent. That was the tent. And you took the bedspread and the blanket off your bed and you threw it underneath and you hung like bath towels on both sides to block the light from coming in, and there was your tent back then. There was no such thing as tents. Maybe there was, but my parents would never afford to buy one. But anyway, we used to sleep out in each other's backyard. Now, sometimes we would do that because it was fun to sleep out, but usually when we decided to sleep out in our backyards, it was because we had a plan to do something that night that our parents didn't want us to do, and we didn't want them to find out. So we'd say, I'm sleeping out. So I would set up a little tent in my backyard, and Mike Rudnick would set up a little tent in his backyard. So we had two tents, and I would say, I'm sleeping out over Mike's house, or he'd say, I'm sleeping out over Kevin's house. Depending on which weekend it was, we would use each other's tent. So this one particular night, we wanted to go to a concert. This was an outdoor concert at Randall's Island. Now, you can Google this, and you can find it. Randall's Island was an island below the Triborough Bridge on Long Island on the way to Manhattan. I lived in Levittown. It was miles away from my house. But this concert, there was going to be Steppenwolf, there was going to be Jethro Tull, there was going to be Jimi Hendrix, there was going to be Grand Funk Railroad. There was all these great bands that were going to play in this concert. Now, we couldn't afford tickets to the concert. So we thought what we would do is sleep out in the backyard around 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, if it gets dark, we'd sneak out and we would hitchhike into the city. And maybe we'd get close enough to Randall's Island to climb a tree and maybe see the bands from afar. So that's what we did. We got inside. Parents didn't notice. We snuck out. We got onto the Long Island Expressway or whichever parkway, and we put on our thumbs at 14 years old, whatever we were, and we went into the city. Well, we hitchhiked all the way in, and we got in there. It must have been about 8, 10 o'clock at night. Well, all of a sudden, we get there, and in those days, some of those concerts, so many people showed up, kind of like the Woodstock thing. They would kick the fences down, and it would turn free. Almost every one of these concerts would turn free. You don't have to even buy a ticket. We get there, and the fence is down, and it's free, and we walk in. We couldn't believe it. We're like 15 years old, and it was a track that went around in a circle. And we walk up to this track, and there's hippies everywhere. You could smell marijuana everywhere. Now, we didn't smoke pot then. We were like 14 or something like that. We probably bought beer and stuff like that. I don't remember. But we brought our tape recorder. We always took a little tape recorder, and we recorded all of these concerts. I've got tons of tapes on this stuff. We went in there, and we got to the front, And we're sitting there, and one band after another comes up. And we could not believe it. I wish I had a camera. I didn't take pictures of this stuff. So, and I can remember us, I don't know who it was. It was either me or Mike Rundig. One of us got a little sick or something because we were drinking stuff. And I can remember listening to the tape like 10 years later. I don't even know what the tape is anymore. And I can hear the band clear as a bell. But that wasn't the funny part. The funny part was listening to me and Mike in the background with our squeaky little 15-year-old voices talking. We'd be like, Mike, what are you doing? Get up. Oh, I'm not feeling good. What do you mean you're not feeling good? The band's up there. Yeah, blah, blah, blah. What are you doing? You're puking on my shoes, you idiot. And all of these little comments behind the music and the tape, that's what really made the event. I mean, I got to go find these tapes. I know I got them someplace. We did so many crazy things at these things, and we went to many, many concerts like that. I can remember on this particular night, it got late, and we had to get back in the tent by 8 o'clock in the morning when the sun came up, because that's when I knew my mom was going to come out and check, see if we want to come in and have breakfast or something. Like, we're interested in breakfast, right? So here we are in we hitchhiked all the way into the city under the Triborough Bridge, Randall's Island. Google it. You're going to find it. It was a concert back in 1970 or 69 or 71. I don't know. Something like that. But I can remember us sitting there sick, you know, kind of getting tired. And I remember Jimi Hendrix coming on. He was the last one to come on. And I remember this very specifically. Jimi Hendrix got up there and he hit one of his chords. Boom. Feedback. You know, he had a million amplifiers behind him. It was wrecking our ears. And then he started playing. And then I remember him taking a bottle of lighter fluid, pouring it on his guitar. This is a true story. Jimi Hendrix. And he lit it. And he took the guitar and he went like this and he flung it out into the audience. And everybody's out there, they're all going nuts, right? We're like, holy cow, we're in a real rock concert. We're like 15. Is this what happens? It was chaos, complete chaos. Then he picked up another guitar and he kept playing. And all of a sudden, the sun's coming up over Jimi Hendrix's shoulder. And we're thinking, holy cow, it's 6 o'clock. We got to get out of here. We got to hitchhike all the way back out to Long Island. We had to leave. I couldn't believe it. We had to leave with Jimi Hendrix on stage. My last memory is me and Mike Rundig walking on the Triborough Bridge away from the concert as the sun is coming up. And we hear Jimmy, excuse me while I kiss the sky. True story. We walked away, and as Jimi Hendrix faded off and the sun was coming up, we hitchhiked. We got two rides. We got back in that tent, bumping by about 8:15, and my mom woke us up. She had no clue that we were never in that tent the night before. We were at a rock concert, 14, 15 years old, a great rock concert. We saw Jimi Hendrix. We saw everybody. Nobody knew. I can't tell you how many times we did that. I told my parents eventually, like, you know, 30 years later. I said, we were never in that stupid tent. You know, back those days, you did that. You know, you were kids and, you know, you lied a little bit. Anyway, that's the rock and roll story. So the moral of that story is, if you're going to sneak out, make sure you leave the concert early enough to hitchhike back and get in the tent before your parents get up. Now, I'm not telling you kids to do stuff like this. Matter of fact, I don't want you doing stuff like that because it was dangerous. Well, it wasn't that dangerous then. It's much more dangerous now. Now you'd never do something like hitchhike. Back then, we did it all the time. Anyway, that's the end of that story. So that's the Jimi Hendrix story. Saw him live. How many people can say they saw Jimi Hendrix live at an outdoor concert, and he lit his guitar on fire and flipped it into the crowd? Holy cow, unbelievable. Anyway, that's the story. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, Planet Hypes. A lot of crazy stories, interesting life. It's going to be the New York Forrest Gump. One of my stories are funnier, and they're all true, and I don't say you all, because that doesn't work for me. Have a great day. Subscribe right now. Take it easy.
Nice.